They treated our water around here with this copper stuff, and it's to restock the Lakeland station. They had to because, we see, the lake we live on is what we get our water from, and it had a real funny taste to it. So they had to put this chemical in it to clean it.
Well, if you're near the mountains, I better hang up. I know it's going to disconnect here.
Okay.
I'll call you back, though, okay?
Okay.
Okay,
are you going to be coming around here anytime?
When I do, I'll for sure stop in.
Okay.
Bye, Lorraine. I'll call you back, okay?
Okay.
Bye.
Bye.
I tell you, Tom, that sounds like a man who generally cares about children, not a man that wants to do harm to children. Your thoughts on the clip I played?
No, that I couldn't understand every word that was said, but that's the childlike Michael, the Michael who is kind and considerate and sensitive to others, particularly children, who constructed Neverland to see children happy, particularly kids from underprivileged backgrounds, children from the inner city, children from the hood, children surrounded by gang violence and poverty and problems with their families. He'd love to see them come to Neverland and just have fun and enjoy themselves. That's the kind, loving, considerate Michael Jackson that I knew and that we all respected and loved. That's who it was. And again, every time I hear something like that, it reminds me how cruel it was to falsely accuse him of these kinds of ugly, you know, charges. I mean, just the cruelty in taking children, you know, who he thought and believed were pure and innocent and you know, people who would not steal from him or want him to do a project for them or try and get money from him, to take children and turn them around and try and make him a monster in a criminal courtroom, but just the cruelest thing anybody could have done to this very gentle, kind spirit. And but that's the kind childlike Michael Jackson that hoped to change the world and make it a better place, and I think he succeeded.
Well, no question. You know, you hear the sincerity with Ryan White. The quality wasn't that great, but you could tell that Michael generally cares for children, doesn't want to do harm to them. He has the child like in him, as Elizabeth Taylor has said, and many other people. And, you know, one day I just hope the Diane Diamonds, Maureen Ortz, and, you know, I'm sure I'm missing a few, will get it right. And, you know, see things the way they should be seen. And let the facts speak for themselves. 12 people said no way. That team said no way. And I think it's time for Diane Diamond, Maureen Orth, and Wendy Murphy and others like that to move on.
Yeah, I think they're too invested in their positions. I think they spent so much time and effort to try and justify and explain their positions, but I don't think you'll see them backtrack anytime soon. They just thought they were riding the crest of a fascinating chapter in world history where, you know, they wanted to see Michael Jackson, you know, who had risen to the greatest heights, they wanted to see him fall and splatter and go to prison. To them, it was an exciting story to write about. And my impression of them is that they think they were denied, you know, that final chapter, and they'll be resentful for the rest of their days. That's how I view them. So I don't think you'll see them change anytime soon, but more importantly, are the millions and millions of people all over the world who loved Michael, appreciated him, and still reflect on his wonderful contributions to the world.
Oh, no question. I mean, did you feel the audience of tears as the verdict got closer, as you got closer to closing arguments? Did it feel good to have, I guess, the home court advantage, if you will?
When you say home court advantage, what do you mean now? You mean the criminal court?
I mean, you take Jody Arias, for example. Obviously, nobody on the outside of the court liked her. But when Mike mm-hmm. would arrive, he had his set fans there who would come from all over to see him and try to get him through this. And I remember that sign, on behalf of mankind, we're sorry. You know, I'm talking about those Oilers fans.
Yes, I mean, it was obviously wonderful to see the fans outside the courthouse supporting him. And, you know, I'll never forget the first day I showed up to appear in that courtroom as his lead criminal defense counsel. There was an African-American woman outside the courtroom with a big sign that said, "The wisdom of God is with you." And I never forgot that because I felt that God was on our side and we... doing the right thing. But I have to tell you, on verdict day, when I was in the courtroom and sat down with Michael and Susan at counsel table, and, you know, for a second I glanced at the spectator section, and it was mostly media, and my impression was that all had a smile on their face. They all were salivating over what they thought was going to be a guilty verdict. They were salivating over the ratings and the drama of seeing him handcuffed and hauled off to jail, prison. And when he was acquitted, and I hugged him, my eye happened to catch a few of these journalists, and they looked very disappointed. So there was a lot of cruelty and a lot of malice and a lot of anger surrounding, you know, that entire process. But by the same token, all of his fans around the world were pulling for him. They were outside the courtroom listening, you know, to every not guilty and verdict and shouting and screaming. So he had his supporters, and he had the people who just appreciated him and never lost faith in him. But unfortunately, there also was an ugly element that wanted the drama to be complete with a conviction and Michael being hauled off to jail and prison. That's what they wanted, and they were very disappointed when it didn't happen.
Like a comet blazing across the evening sky, gone too soon. Like a rainbow fading in the twinkling of an eye, gone too soon. Sparkling and splendidly bright, here one day, gone one night, like the loss of sunlight on a cloudy afternoon. On a sandy beach, gone too soon. Like a perfect flower that is just beyond your reach, gone too soon. Like a sunset dying with the rising of the moon.